So Eli, you and I have met each other through Sales Enablement Society and then through a lot of other events. And you know, I think it's fun. I've been out to your Multiplier event, which is just a great event, really trying to highlight the heroes of sales enablement who are increasing their performance and multiplying the effect of their sales organizations. And I really do. There's two books on sales enablement, and you know that Rob Peterson and I are doing research on sales enablement. And there's two books that we actually are quoting in our academic research, and this is one of the two books. And so we have three papers that are in the mix. One of them, I think you got an early look at, that just hit the market in Journal of Selling. And so Eli is a great supporter of sales enablement, and truly this book on sales enablement mastery is to me, it's like the field general's guide. You know, we have a colleague, Tamara Shank, who provided kind of the diagram of how to maybe build it out with a lot of technical components. And then if I'm the field general, this is my manual in the field, right? When I'm sitting in the field and saying, how do I really increase performance? Let me pick something. And I know that I told you this when you gave me a chance to pre-read this one. And I was marking almost every page with like, wow, I need to change that. Wow, I need to change that. Wow. And then just little tidbits on how to increase the performance of your organization. So I'm really excited today to invite you to our Sales Leadership Summit virtually. And we definitely want to thank you for the invitation that you've made to the sales enablement community. And you and I have talked about this offline. We're going to make that a 2020, not just this event, but for this event and the event we do in November, that we're going to try and bring sales enablement people in the Dallas Metroplex into these leadership summits. And we thank SalesHood for providing the funding to allow us to do that so that they get some exposure to some of the things. And what I'm really impressed with about what you talk about, Eli, is really moving some of this, the work that needs to be done, down to the trenches. And how do you empower the organization down in the level of the organization, down to where the leaders are and really making impact? And today you're going to talk to us about how to kind of work rethinking enablement, given the fact that we actually aren't sitting in a pod at work anymore. We're actually sitting across the country with staring at walls and saying, shh, be quiet right now. So we're dealing with homeschooling while we're trying to get work done. So without further ado, I'll give you the floor and
look forward
to hearing what you have to say today, Eli.
Perfect. I appreciate that very nice and warm introduction, and also appreciate that you did take the time to pre-read Enablement Mastery, and you also read my first book as well, and love the feedback on both. And also super grateful for the endorsement that you gave to me in Enablement Mastery and the ongoing support that you provide the sales enablement community and myself, my company, and all of our constituents. So thank you. And thank you, Stephanie, for kind of getting all this organized, and to the entire UTD school. We're super grateful to be a part of the community. Dallas is a great, great, great community. There are a ton of sales folks there. It's a hotbed of sales management, sales leadership, a hotbed of just innovation, and we're grateful to be a part of it. And when we started talking about the virtual summit, you know, what I was going to talk about, which was measuring your impact and correlating performance data and all this amazing awesomeness of sales enablement, once we were hit with the crisis, it became clear that we needed to be really prescriptive to our sales leaders around the world and sales managers and CEOs around how they can rethink, how they must rethink sales enablement in the context of everybody working from home. And so we adjusted the topic, and you're going to see some fresh, oh, can I screen share?
Yes, let me make you host.
Absolutely. You're going to see some fresh content here. We've done some amazing work in the last 2 weeks, just rethinking sales and I appreciate the opportunity to share. So, I think my overall thesis, and not thesis, you're schooling me. I'm kind of getting a little bit, thinking of school now because of all the great thesis that you do, Dr. Dover. My overall hypothesis here is, given what's going on in the world, it is time. And this is the time for sales enablement to step up. And I'm going to show you in this talk ways that sales leaders, marketers, product marketers, sales ops, sales enablement folks, this isn't just for sales enablement, but sales enablement is a function that company-wide. And we're going to talk about ways that organizations can step up. I'm going to let Stephanie kind of guide with questions as they come in. So feel free to post questions. And if one comes up, Stephanie, I'll gladly just kind of take it. Let's make it as interactive as we can. So this is the time for sales enablement to step up. And why? Well, you know what? There are 11,000 sales enablement professionals, give or take a couple. If you go to LinkedIn, there are 15 million sellers in North America. Actually, it's the United States of America. That's data from the United States Labor. So just think of that ratio for a second. Like, we're already behind. There were 11,000 salesman professionals there to enable, train 15 million sellers. And now all of a sudden everybody's working from home. Like, we've just, kind of 100x the complexity of our jobs. And as enablement professionals. And that's the world that we're living in right now. We need to be creative. We need to be communicative. We need to be coaching more. And we need to do so much to help our people while they're working from home. And so, I thought we would start just with a definition of what is sales enablement. It's in the book. And I do this every time I speak. Whoever has not already purchased my book, and whoever sends me a note of gratitude, thank you very much. Not an email, LinkedIn message, an actual handwritten thank you card, because I'm a believer in old school relationships and I don't want the thank you card to go away. If anybody says thank you for your talk, appreciated it, you can say whatever you want in the card. I will send you a book to your home. So that way, it's a way of just embracing the importance of the human to human connection and thank you card. So please, if you haven't got the book, get my address from the website and we'll gladly send you one. And that's the book that Dr. Dover just shared. So let's just agree on what is sales enablement, so that way we can from here build a foundation for how we can rethink it. So enablement is the alignment of people, processes, and priorities with relevant learning, coaching, and communications delivered at the right time to achieve revenue and growth goals. Now, I want to punctuate this definition with a story. And it's a story that's really relevant in these times. In 2007, 2008, when we hit an economic downturn, I was working at Salesforce.com. I was the senior vice president of sales productivity. And Mark Benioff pulled me into his office. And he said, you know what we're going to do right now? We're going to hire more reps. We're going to train them. We're going to onboard them. We're going to get ready because this economy is going to turn around. And I want to have an army of people on message. And I want them coached and trained and ready to go. You ready? And I said, I'm ready. And then he went through and shared with me the latest pitch, the latest messages from the corporate pitch. And then that was how we started driving enablement. Mark Benioff had a vision for sales enablement, and it was complete alignment of messaging across the entire enterprise. He wanted every single salesperson to understand what they should be saying, when they should be saying it, and to make sure they were delivering the right messages in a consistent way across the world. And my job at Salesforce was to run around the world, planes, trains, and automobiles. And I had a team. By the time I left, I had a team of 120 people, right? So just think about that for a moment. If you think back of those ratios, today we have 11,000 people servicing 15 million salespeople. At Salesforce, I had 120 people servicing about 3,000 to 4,000 sellers. So we were over investing in enablement, and with Mark's leadership and the leadership of Salesforce back in 2008, we were making sure that like our salespeople were aligned with our sales process or sales playbooks. And we would, just like we're doing this, but we would do it face to face. We'd sit down and they would be presenting to us the corporate pitch. They present to us their demos and we had to test them and certify them. Right? That's how important sales enablement was to Salesforce. And frankly, that story has proven to yield amazing results, because look at that rocket ship. So sales enablement works. Sales enablement, when it's leadership driven, works beautifully. When you've got CEO and the leadership buy-in, it's unstoppable. And so I wrote a whole book about the principles and the guides and what to do for sales enablement, but it's not just at Salesforce. So the point I want to make is sales enablement is a strategy, a business strategy that hyper growth companies, that any growth company subscribes to. You look at any of these three organizations, RingCentral, DocuSign, it's another great company we work with. RingCentral's stock price, you know, in the last 3 years, since they decided to double down, triple down on enablement under the leadership of Siobhan Thatcher, using a technology system to help them scale, their stock price is 10x'd, their bookings is 3x'd, their pipeline is 5 to 10x, depending on the segment, their win rates of three, like their stats are off the charts. So the lesson is, A, read the book, because the book's going to tell you how to embrace sales enablement and what is it that you should do to draw sales enablement as a top line revenue priority. And B, this isn't just a Salesforce phenomenon. Look at companies like RingCentral, Sage, Tealium, DocuSign, and the list goes on and on and on. And so I love Salesforce, and I founded Sales at my company to build and to deliver to the market a sales enablement platform. So we could take all the best practices that you read about in the book, all the best practices that we did at Salesforce, and now let's deliver it at scale. Learning, coaching, selling. How do you get people to be on message? Remember when Benioff said to me, hey, I want you to go train, coach, and certify every single salesperson on the planet, and you need to make sure you're sitting in front of them, you meaning my team and I, and that they can deliver the pitch. Well, look what we can do at scale now. Apropos for what's happening, how are you going to get folks on your team certified when you can't sit in front of them face to face? So our platform delivers that at scale. I'm not here to pitch the platform. I'm here to share with you some insights. And so what I did was I looked at the usage and the data trends from our platform for the last 2 weeks. I thought, you know, let's look at my 100 customers. Let's look at our 100 customers across 50,000 people, 50 countries, and let's see what are they doing differently in the last 2 weeks than they've done, you know, in the last 3 months, 12 months. And so what you're seeing here is a word cloud of all the great coaching and content and training that they've created. And so I can tell you 2 weeks ago, they weren't thinking remote. I can tell you they weren't thinking home environment, work environment, but I can tell you that it's business as usual for these hyper growth companies. And even more so, they're still doing onboarding. They're still using video-based storytelling. They're still doing a lot of workshops, but they're doing everything in a system. In the last 2 weeks, we've seen a 250% increase compared to the 2 weeks before, year over year. It's a pretty significant increase. And it just tells you that these companies are thinking, wow, we got to do more. We got to do more online coaching, online learning. Distant learning is here to stay. And you got to do more than just setting up in a WebEx or a Zoom call, because you got to drive accountability. We've seen 1,200 coaching huddles launched in the last 2 weeks. That's also a dramatic increase in 500 million coaching activities. So even while this crisis is happening, smart companies are investing in their teams, they're developing their people, and they're continuing to train and onboard. And yeah, in some cases, they're leveling up. You know, like I heard in the previous talk, you know, it's time to, you know, kind of level up the team a little bit. Don't stop hiring, don't stop recruiting, keep that funnel going. But I thought it would be interesting for folks to just see in the last 2 weeks, what are some of the program types people are running? Onboarding, clearly sales is the focus. People are continuing to invest in sales. A lot of release training, the remote training. So I don't know, it's kind of insightful. And I think so. And Eli, is there any questions?
Yes, we do have a question. So the 500 million in coaching activities, they're curious what it was before 2 weeks ago.
Right. So again, this is a 250% usage increase. So in the first 2 weeks, it was half of that, 250% less. So that 250% usage increase is the coaching activities number increase.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah. No, you're welcome. You're welcome. So, you know, I was anticipating, right? And by the way, hey, the usage increase is not consistent across the board. So it's actually higher in some companies. About 50% of our companies have done, you know, they're seeing even a higher increase. But if you look at this across, all companies are how do I say it? They've all leaned into distant learning, virtual coaching in different ways and at different amounts. But I can tell you, every one of our customers, all 100 companies, they've got a very intensive, yet accountable, and at the same time, what's the right word? Approachable calendar, enablement calendar for April. And so each one of our customers is building a calendar where they are defining weekly goals, monthly goals, topics by week to keep people on message and keep people accountable for maintaining this learning and coaching culture. So thank you for the question. Any other questions?
Not at this time.
Okay. So I was, you know, listen, you know, when you look at the data, you always wonder which way is it going to trend. And, you know, we're super pleased to know that we're helping companies make it through this time. And I'm going to talk about an offer that we have later. We're also, as a company, one of the things we did was we had to pivot our conference, just like the virtual summit here did for UTD. And so last week was supposed to be our annual conference. So we switched a day and a half conference into a 30-day live virtual multipliers experience. And so, part of our experience, so we have 15 talks over 30 days. We're excited. It starts tomorrow. One of the things we did was everybody who is participating in the multipliers conference, we asked them a simple question. So they log into the community and they introduce themselves because we're trying to drive, you know, connections and community. And they're asked to introduce themselves and answer this question: what changes will you be making? Oh, sorry for the double two, to enable your teams in these times. This is hot off the press, even with the typo. And so what I'm going to share with you right now is the combination of the insights that we're seeing from our customers, data-driven insights, along with the stories that our customers have been sharing with us around what they're doing differently. And we've come up with five. So I've got a ton of videos in our community. It's amazing. I'm connecting with so many sales enablement professionals now, and they're in there and they're sharing some of their challenges and what's working and what are they doing differently. And it's beautiful to just connect with everyone. So this is a visual of what our community looks like. And so first, so these are five ways companies are rethinking their sales enablement programs with their teams working from home. First and foremost, we got to get everybody more comfortable and competent at being able to run virtual remote meetings. So we rolled out inside of our platform a complete curriculum for remote selling. And this is available right now. And so 25% of our customers have already run their teams through this in the last 7 days. And we're anticipating that everyone's going to run their teams or have it scheduled to run. And so every single person that recorded a video, they said, you know, part of our enablement program now is we got to skill up our people so they're better at simple things like setting up their remote work environments. Like, what does their space look like? How are they angling their cameras? How comfortable are they with whatever the technology is? What tools are they using? You know, are they going to use a whiteboard? Are they going to take notes? How are they going to take notes? You know, what are they going to do? How do they set agendas? Like, there's a whole level of skills that we weren't necessarily prioritizing as, oh, we got to get our people trained on this quickly. I read an interesting quote on Twitter that someone said, you know, companies have been spending years and years and billions of dollars getting ready for digital transformations. And then all of a sudden, now they're ready, or at least they need to get ready. So that digital transformation that companies have been spending quarters and years getting ready for, it just happened overnight. And so now the companies are going to really succeed, and the companies are going to really do well, or the companies are going to be thoughtful about how are they enabling their teams to be great at delivering amazing, effective and conducting remote meetings. So anyone on the call, go to my website, you can request access to the remote selling program that we have. But however you develop your program, if you haven't thought about ways to coach your people, get them comfortable around ways that they can be better at running these kind of meetings, you got to make that a priority. So that's change number one. Remote selling wasn't something that was kind of priority number one. And you saw it show up in the word cloud as well. So that's number one, Stephanie, and feel free to stop me if there's a question.
I will.
Change number two. So, you know, I think what we're seeing consistently across our 100 companies is they're all rethinking their corporate pitch. How do they want to communicate their solution offering? How are they going to communicate their value given what's going on in the world? Think about back in 2008 when Benioff pulled me into his office and said, we're going to now train and coach people on what we do and why we do it. You know, we need to talk about different value-based principles. Back in 2008, we talked about cost reduction. We talked about cloud as being a way to reduce costs and normalize and rationalize IT expenditures. Okay, that makes sense. And so many of the companies that are working with us right now, they've reformatted their positioning. They've come up with new corporate pitch decks. And now they're going to spend April getting their sales teams to learn the new pitch. They're going to get them sharing their pitches with each other. They're going to get managers giving them coaching. And then they're going to develop and gamify that whole experience. And so this is something that regardless of whether you have systems or technology to do it, if you're going to one of the things you need to do when you rethink with your teams working from home is you got to figure out a way to get them on message quickly. And whether you're going to set up a Zoom and then just have people present or whether you're going to do it in an asynchronous fashion, this is critical. You know, the market has changed, your value prop is changing, and it's so critical that everybody is comfortable with the new messaging and that what you're doing is you're making sure that you and your teams are sharing back with you that they're comfortable sharing the new messaging. So this is a really, really important change that's happening. And I'm seeing it. Almost all of our customers are rolling out messaging certifications in the April timeframe. Everybody, across the board. This is something that, whether it's a short elevator pitch, whether it's 10 new slides, the world is different and has changed, and now we gotta make sure everybody's aligned with that. So that's change number two. Change number three, clearly, you know, we're seeing a lot of video first communications. And with sales enablement, you know, I believe, and we're seeing an increase in this as well. We're seeing a lot more one-on-ones happening now using video-based collaboration. So I'm just gonna, you know, the message here is sales enablement and rethinking sales enablement needs to be video first, especially in these uncertain times. People want to see your eyes. People want to hear you. They want to see the authenticity of what's going on. They want to have that human connection. And so, you know, doing a video first communication, and it should span all communications, whether it's CEO level communications, you know, sales leader communications, marketing leadership communications, sales manager, frontline manager communications, one-on-one communications, employee recognition communications, win story recognitions. And you know, I'm seeing a ton of happy hours. So folks are comfortable doing happy hours. So, you know, we should be able to start looking at ways that we can drive enhancing in our communications. And so this is, you know, really critical. So this is a big change as well. If you weren't already a video first communications culture, this is a big change that needs to happen immediately. In order to just drive that connection with your teams and to get people feeling connected, and especially while folks are working from homes. And all three of these, by the way, they're going to stick once life comes back to normal and our new normal kind of readjusts and we normalize into whatever the future is going to be. You know, I believe we've taught ourselves the importance of these. So number four, I believe this is the time. So if sales enablement needs to step up, which we are, and it's amazing to see sales enablement professionals really stepping up. It's also the time for frontline managers to step up. We need to distribute sales enablement to them. And this is my first book is all about enabling managers to play an active role in the sales enablement framework. And so, you know, managers need training on how to run their weekly team meetings. Managers need to be the ones delivering role playing. Managers need to be the ones doing collaborative deal coaching. Managers need to be the ones using technology, and they got to now rely on those call recordings. And so I put this quote up here because a lot of our customers that recorded their intro stories in the Multipliers conference, the ones that recorded this week, a few of them said, you know, now's the time that we need to build this into our culture. Show me, don't tell me, right? Show me that you know the message. Show me that you understand what your strategy is. Don't just tell me. And so I think our managers need to have that become the default. Yeah, I know you got it. Ain't gonna fly when everybody's working from home. So show me, don't tell me. This is a big change. I'm gonna attribute this quote to Barry Ryan, who's been an advisor and a coach and a mentor to me. And I'm super grateful for him. So show me, don't tell me. And it's an important, I just want that tagline to sit with folks. And, you know, Dave Apple over at Sage is a leader as a frontline manager. I love sharing his story. Because Dave, he's a believer in show me, don't tell me. And so he consistently runs weekly huddles. And we just did a webinar with him a few weeks ago prior to all this going down. And in that weekly webinar, he shared his perfect huddle. And you can see it here. Every week he brings his team together. He loads new messaging. He has a coaching moment. And then he's got deal reviews, pitch practice. And then everybody's got to load a live call. Boom. And so that's sales manager excellence. Stephanie, I think you may have gotten a question.
Yes, we did. When we are seeking a new job and are interested in an organization that has tools like this, where would you direct us? If development, learning, and employee engagement is an important priority, where do we need to find these engaged companies to narrow in our search?
So if someone's looking for work and they want to know which companies have these kind of principles and values in their, is that the question, Stephanie?
Angela, is that correct?
I think, do I want?
Yes, that is correct.
So it's interesting, you know, you'll find in the job descriptions, there should be a bullet point, familiar with modern learning. You know, and they'll even name some companies, right? Saleshood is a modern sales enablement platform. There are other companies like Seismic, like HighSpot. There's a whole bunch of these companies that offer solutions. So I would look for companies, and in the job descriptions that the requirement, there should be some. And then, you know, so that's how I would look in the job specs. Like, for example, you know, you look at DocuSign's job descriptions for sales enablement professionals, they're quoting in their familiarity with Saleshood, right? So they'll even list the technology in there. I don't know if that's answering the question or not, Stephanie. Maybe check with Angela.
Angela?
Well, Eli, I would think as well, would you think it'd be fair to say that companies that you highlight on your website and in your Multipliers event are probably going to be companies that are of a good culture and are probably doing some of the things you're talking about?
Absolutely. And you know, listen, the companies that we work with are getting tremendous value out of embracing sales enablement. A lot of the companies we're working with are already doing a lot of these principles. So that's why I can look into their usage patterns, anonymize what they're doing, and then share insights for the world and say, hey, these are what the fastest growing, most forward-thinking companies are doing, and they're already doing it, right? They're already rolling out stuff in March and April, and they're not waiting for you know, a couple of months. And so absolutely, you can go to the website, look at the logos, look at the job descriptions. Also, open invitation, if anybody is looking for a position, we do have an accreditation, and it's the expert certification. And if you get into the Saleshood sales enablement community, you can already connect with hundreds of sales enablement people, and you can start asking them, are you hiring? And so it's, I'm not suggesting we're a job board at all. That's not what we do, but the community, it's an obvious thing. Are you hiring? What's going on? And also I invite anyone who wants to learn about sales enablement, in addition to whatever your resources are, you can apply to become part of our community, and you can go through and get expert certified. If you go to the LinkedIn, Saleshood's LinkedIn, a company profile, you'll see right there, it's pretty amazing. Every day we're highlighting two or three new people that have completed the certification. And so we believe in sales enablement, and whether you're using sales or not, it's irrelevant, right? I think embracing the principles, applying these principles to help you rethink sales enablement in your companies and to modernize how you're enabling your people is really what we're about. And there's a lot of different technologies that can help you do it at scale. We're one of them. But really, the principles remain core. And I love the question, Stephanie and Howard and Angela, thank you, because you want to connect with an organization that subscribes to these principles at the highest level and in their values and in their culture. It's a great question. I'm going to highlight that more in my talk. Thank you. So that's change four. Change four. So change five. This is something that's happening. It's amazing. So for those of you that are newer to sales enablement, onboarding is an amazing way to boost productivity, right? If you look at the RingCentral story I shared, one of the key things that RingCentral did was they're able to get their sales teams and their revenue teams hitting quota faster so they can ultimately close revenue faster, right? That was one of the things we did at Salesforce. We knew that if we hired people, trained them quickly, and had them hitting quota and contributing revenue faster, that we would ultimately have a higher, we close business faster. That's what I do. And so ramp and onboarding is an amazing revenue driver, because if you can get people hitting quota faster, it's amazing. And so the way organizations have done it in the past is, you know, saleshood aside and modern learning and modern coaching aside, most organizations will fly people to a central location and, you know, have them train them for a week or two and then send them off their way, right? And that's the majority, right? Most of our customers will have a pre-work experience where they do self-paced, activity-based learning for a couple of weeks. Then they'll fly them to some central location, and then they'll have some kind of post-work where they're doing daily, weekly check-ins, and the system is there to guide them. And so they've got like a 30, 60, 90-day path, and it's organized by role, right? And so a lot of our customers will do it that way. But guess what's happened? All of our customers have lost this middle. So every single one of our customers is now having to go 100% live virtual. So whatever you're doing to train and onboard your new hires, you're going to need to make it 100% live virtual. So that means some of it will be delivered through calls. Some of it will be self-paced learning. You're going to do assessments. You're going to do mentoring. There'll be buddy systems. And ultimately, you're going to want to measure and correlate all that activity to leading indicators and make sure that you're delivering and hitting your goals. And so this is a big change. I'm seeing this, like if you go back to the word cloud, you know, that I showed you way back when, where was it? Onboarding in the middle. Most of the companies that we're working with, they're rethinking their onboarding. And so they've relaunched their onboarding. They have republished the content. They had to, because it's a big driver and they know that it's a big, big benefit to their organizations. And most, anyway, so I'm gonna stop there on that point. So those are the big five changes. Right? I'll just kind of do them. 17, we got 3 minutes, Steph. Time check? Good.
Yes, 3 minutes.
So change number one, just to recap, remote selling, and I do want to thank our friends at Winning by Design. They made their content available for free inside of Saleshood, and it's available to anyone here that wants it. So if you're not thinking remote selling, it's time to do so. New messaging alignment, you got to get your teams aligned with your latest messaging. Video first communications, show me, don't tell me, should be the mindset of your frontline managers in how they're coaching their teams. Your onboarding should be 100% virtual. And my executive chair from my board, she wrote a blog that we published a few days ago on what leading from home looks like, right? Not just working from home. Now, how do we lead from home? This has huge implications for sales enablement as we're trying to get our frontline managers to be better. And I thought I would just share it here. I love the third one. We got to fight like hell for our customers to keep them. And so anyway, I encourage you to go find this amazing blog. Lindsay's a great leader. She worked with me at Salesforce as well. And so I'm going to close with this. If anybody wants to embrace sales enablement in a scalable, repeatable, and engaging and super fun way. You're able to do it for free with Saleshood. We've got a special offer right now. And so you can rethink sales enablement right now and embrace a system to help you do it. And so that's my offer to anyone here. Go to my website, sign up. We'll get you set up with your own hood, you know, within 24 hours and love to do that for free. Want to just do a double reminder on our conference. And if anybody does want to join the conference, please do so. Direct message me. I'll get you a code. It's an amazing experience. We've got, every Tuesday, Thursday, another fabulous speaker that is a set of speakers that are going to share ways that they're doing enablement to drive value in their organizations, just like I share with you today. And then just the key takeaways. First of all, I just got to stay strong, be safe and healthy, right? Please, please, please. Physical distance living and social distance living is our reality for a while, and it's making a difference, especially out here in California. And just, again, those five key takeaways: get everyone on message, continue to invest in your people, get folks comfortable with remote selling, lean on your managers to do more coaching, and work hard to move your onboarding to be 100% virtual. The slides, Howard and Stephanie, are on my LinkedIn profile, so I posted them at the top of the hour. So if anybody wants to download the PDF, you can, and take questions if there are any more.
There are not at this time, but I'll give people a couple seconds to type it in if they have it.
So I'd like to put a little pitch in for the Multipliers Conference. That was probably one of the coolest conferences because you're trying to highlight those people. You know, for those that don't understand a multiplier, this is this idea that if we do this right, we should be experiencing like what Beck Holland talked about today. She said when she deployed the right sales enablement concepts within her team, she had a 6x performance increase. You know, we should see those kind of things in today's economy. We shouldn't be seeing just marginal increases. We should be seeing multipliers when we do it right. And so this is a conference where you actually highlight the people who are making those kind of contributions. And it's just an amazing event. I appreciated getting a chance to be part of it and learning from the people who are truly multiplying their effect. And so what a great thing. And obviously all through the month of April, people can patch into Saleshood's event and learn from people who are making it happen every day.
Anybody listening, I appreciate that, Howard. Anybody listening, you can register right now and EC, big E, big C, guest, all lowercase, 100% discount for anyone on the call here. Love to contribute to the Dallas community and UTD any way I can. And this is a spectacular conference, right? I just gave you a snippet, like just an overview of some of the ways companies are rethinking sales enablement. These are the real stars. These are the multipliers, right? Tealium, Sage, Demandbase, TriNet. They're going to share what they're doing all in the name of how they're driving impact in their organization. So join us and become a part of the multipliers community as well.
You bet. Thank you, Eli. Be safe out there. I hope you guys stay well, and that life is going well. I know you have some other things going on.
Thank you. I really appreciate being a part of this. Good to meet everyone. Thank you for the questions. Connect with me on LinkedIn and look forward to hearing everyone I look forward to coming out to Dallas this year. I look forward to coming out to Dallas this year and seeing everyone in person. We're going to make that happen as a society.
Stephanie, I'll let you know the November event has been pinned down, so we'll have to